have a tendency to speak fast and loud, so my apologies to those of you trying to take a nap in advance. My name is Vishal, and I joined Dropbox 4 months ago to work on our developer tools. And today, specifically, I'd like to take some of the time to talk about the few weeks that we spent implementing a what I think is a scalable CI system. But first, a little bit of context about Dropbox. We have a legacy app, and actually, it's a testament to the developers that originally wrote the app that the code has stuck around for so long. But that also means that it's a very tightly knit code base, and it's a monolithic code base. Thankfully, we have a lot of tests for it, and we like running these tests. We run them all the time. In fact, not only do we run them after every commit, but we run them during code reviews, and in fact, we run them the first time you fire off a code review, and then we run them again every time you make an edit and on every snapshot. So we run them very, very frequently, and we have a lot of different types of tests. We've got unit tests, we've got integration tests, we've got Selenium tests, and as you can imagine, some of these are very slow and they take a long time to run. In fact, if you tried to run all of our tests one after the other serially, it would take several days to get through all of it. So that makes for a difficult time when you're trying to commit to the repository. Obviously, nobody wants to wait hours or days to be able to submit a CL. And that means that you have a lot of fun times trying to figure out why a test broke in your continuous integration system. And so we were having a lot of fun. We said that we need to have less fun. But there are a lot of aspects of this that we wanted to keep. So for instance, we really liked that we had tight integration with our developer workflows and with our code review tools. And in fact, we wanted to add more data into the code review process. So for instance, Andre talked about earlier showing coverage data, branch coverage, getting those signals into the code review tools and the code review process. So that was great. And we also wanted to run our tests very frequently. In fact, we want our tests to not only run within our CI system or code review process, but we also want it to run during development so that developers are continuously running tests as they're writing code. But that means that we need tests that are fast. And when I say fast, I mean tests that will run on the order of minutes, like 5 minutes or less than 10 minutes. And we figured that the way that we get to that is by scaling. And when I say scale, I specifically mean massive parallelism. And that's what I'm gonna call sharded tests. But you don't wanna spend a ton of money, like millions and millions of dollars in running these tests. And so you wanna be smart about how you use resources in running these tests, and that's what I'm calling controlling your workloads. And I'm gonna spend most of the time today talking about the first part of this, which is sharded tests, which is where we've done the bulk of our work. All right, so how do you get to massive parallelism? Obviously, you can't get parallelism on a single machine, so the first thing that you need is a distributed system. And so this is what like a standard distributed CI system looks like. You have some servers on the far top right, my right, I guess, you guys' left, that take in requests, either through like a web UI or some sort of a command line, and they stick these requests into a database, and then you have some workers that pull each request off out of the database and run them in an isolated environment. And that's great because you can now always be running tests and always kicking off requests for your tests, and you can scale the number of servers that you want. You can scale your database, and you can scale your data center. But that does not mean that each invocation will be fast. If you want fast tests, then you need to make a slight tweak to this model, and you need to introduce sharding. And so the basic concept of sharding is that whenever you get a request, you break it up into little batches or little bits, and each one of those bits is a shard, and you run each one of those shards in parallel. So now, not only are you running each request in parallel, but you're potentially running each test within a request in parallel. And that way you can dramatically reduce the amount of time that it takes to run a test. But you need to be smart about how you do your sharding. If you just evenly break up the tests, then you might end up with a really long running shard. And then if you have a long pull like that, then you don't see any benefits from actually doing sharding because your developer is still sitting there as a machine waiting for that long pull to finish. And so we figured that, all right, we need to be smart about how we do sharding, and we need to try to get as even a distribution of tests that we can based off of runtime. And we figured that the best way to do that is to use historical runtime. Okay, fantastic. So we have a bunch of requirements, and we need to implement this system, and we needed it implemented yesterday because we're already burning a lot of developer time. So what do we do? Well, we looked at what's out there and open source. And one of the most popular systems out there is Jenkins. And Jenkins is great because it's distributed. And so we said, all right, we built a system. We built our CI around Jenkins. And we started throwing lots and lots of shards at it. And then it fell over. And the reason that it fell over is because Jenkins is designed to be serial. It's not designed to handle significant sharding or batching and caching. So I said, all right, what else is out there? Well, there's Travis CI. And there are actually, there's TeamCD and there are a bunch of other tools out there that do it well, but they didn't fit our model. We wanted to be able to run our tests very tightly integrated with our developer workflows and outside of CI. And the more that we looked at different tools out there, the more we realized that a lot of these tools were built for a different paradigm, not necessarily the web paradigm, and were kind of retrofitted for the web paradigm. So we said, all right, you know what? Open source CI is great for isolated systems and isolated repositories, but in our web world, we need a new stack. And we figured that, all right, web stacks are predictable. There are a lot of resources out there. Everybody kind of understands them. So why don't we use a web stack to build our CI for our web paradigm and our web app? Okay, so that's what we did, and we called it changes. And this is kind of what it looks like. It looks very similar to the stack that I spoke about. And what changes does is that it uses a bunch of open source technologies like Apache Mesos and LXC, and orchestrates all of these together to give you a distributed scalable CI. And so the way that it works is that anytime that a changes server gets a request, it looks at the historical runtime for the tests within that, and it automatically figures out how to shard those tests to achieve, the shortest total runtime. And it sticks each one of those shards into the database as a request, as a task. And then there's a changes extension for Mesos that tells Mesos that there's this task that's waiting to run. And I'll talk a little bit about Mesos and LXC as well. But we run this entire system within EC2, which gives us elastic capacity so that we can quickly scale not only the number of workers that we need to handle all of the requests that we're throwing at it, but also run a lot of different shards within the threads or within the test suites. OK, and LXC, it stands for Linux containers. This gives us isolation or test isolation so that two tests that are running within a shard don't interfere with each other. And we can do that without sacrificing performance because we're running in Linux and EC2 is all Linux-based. And then Mesos is this really cool framework that kind of abstracts away all the hardware, the physical hardware for you. So we just tell Mesos that we have a bunch of different machines in EC2, and this is the specification of all these machines. And we, on the other hand, we tell it that, all right, we want to run all of these shards. And Mesos kind of efficiently figures out how to allocate these things, and it monitors tasks to make sure that they're done. And whenever they're completed, it picks up the next task from the database. And like I said, changes is a system that orchestrates all of these parts together to build CI at scale. OK, so we have a system that'll let us run a lot of tests, that'll handle a lot of load. But we want it to be fast without spending a ton of money. And this is where the second part of the talk comes in, which is controlling the amount of workloads that you throw at it. Now, a lot of the stuff at this point in time, a lot of this is just ideas that we have for building features into changes. And it's a lot of active discussion. But in no particular order, one of the things that we're thinking about is this idea of having composable projects. So changes already has this concept of a project where you associate a bunch of tests with, you know, some settings and some notification preferences. But what if each one of these tests, or what if each one of these projects was a module of its own? Then you can start doing things like saying, all right, for my team, I'm going to have two projects. I'm going to have a project that has unit tests and a project that has integration tests. And if I tie these two together into a pipeline and stagger them in some way, then I don't have to run my integration tests until all of my unit tests pass. And then that way, I can get more specific notifications about what failed rather than a test failed or a bunch of tests failed. Or for instance, if you wanted to do release, then you can build a release unit composed of multiple different projects saying that, all right, I have a library out here that I care about, and this library has some tests, and I have a bunch of code over here that I care about that has some tests. And if each one of those is in this different project, then you can define a release pipeline that says that only run the release tests or only be ready for release when each one of these is ready to go. Of course, you only want to run the tests that are affected. You don't want to run all the tests that aren't related to the code that you touch, and you want to cache aggressively in the case that, in whichever cases you can. But the last thing that I wanted to touch upon is being able to structure your repositories. So like I mentioned earlier, at Dropbox, we have a monolithic code base. But this monolithic code base is actually spread out over multiple different repositories. And I think there's a lot of debate and there's a lot of religion around how repositories should be structured. But if we structure it the right way, then we can leverage that in controlling our workloads. So finally, I wanted to mention that there are a lot of tools out there for doing continuous integration. It's hard to get them to work at scale, but it is possible if you use the web paradigm. And we did it using changes, and all of our work is open sourced, and it's available at github.com/dropbox/changes. So feel free to take a look at it, and feel free to put together your own scalable CI using the pieces that we did for your own use cases. All right, any questions?
Does this impact how you design your automated tests?
Does this impact how we design our automated tests? So our philosophy was to essentially support all of the existing tests that we had. And for the most part, we wanted to do it without having to change the tests. Now, you do have implications. If you're going to run multiple tests in parallel, then there are some implications. And I think that Ankit did a really great job earlier today talking about some of those concepts. So for instance, having hermetic servers or controlling the lifetime of the data that your tests manage, those are really, really important concepts. So for instance, we had some cases in which we had one test that did a lot of setup, and then all of the tests that came after it kind of assumed that the setup existed, or this, whether it was a server that was running or whether it was data, was already there within the database. And if you're going to try to run tests in parallel, that just doesn't work. Each test has to contain the lifetime of the servers that it manages, the lifetime of the data that it cares about, and it has to create that data. So there were some changes that we needed to make to some of our tests to get it to work in this world. But for the most part, our philosophy was, let's try and make it possible to run our tests as is.
How do you manage the different branches? That does all your different branch codes run on the same continuous integration environments?
Oh yeah, that's a great question. So this was one of the other things that we did not find very good support for in open source. So with changes recognizes multiple branches. So it will take a look at your repository, and now we're getting into some of the specifics. So specifically, Git repositories or Mercurial repositories, and it'll recognize that it has separate branches, and you set up it automatically sets up a different CI for each one of the branches. And you can manage notifications based off of branches if you needed to. But by default, out of the box, what you're going to get is it's going to monitor the master branch or the default branch, depending on which VCS you're using. And it will look only at the commits to that branch, and it will give you data for that branch. But it's just a configuration setting if you wanted to support all branches or a particular subset of branches. But yeah, we have support for branches built into changes.
And one more question. The nodes that on which you are running the test, suppose you want to replicate the nodes. You have some scripts which can just create a node. So you're using EC2. So are you using the templates and the chef recipes which just copies and creates the new nodes?
So that's a good question as well. So we don't, from EC2, all we get is just bare metal, just like literally just hardware. And we hand that off to Mesos, right? The setup or the environment that's specific to a test, all of that is encoded within the LXC container. And so between the two of those, the LXC container, you can give us an LXC container if you have some custom setup. And we will install, we will replicate that same setup using, we take snapshots of the container. And so we will replicate the data across multiple nodes when we want to run your test. And so the easiest way to do that is to just give us a snapshot of an LXC container, and then we'll replicate that for you. But we don't actually use EC2 to do the replication for us.
Thank you very much, Vishal.